Hello guys, welcome to Algorithms Made Easy. My name is Rajat and today we will be discussing the question frog jump. In this question we are given that a frog is crossing a river. The river is divided into some number of units and at each unit there may or may not exist a stone. The frog can jump on a stone but it may not jump into the water. Given a list of stone positions in sorted ascending order, we need to determine if the frog can cross the river by landing on the last stone. Initially, the frog is on the first stone and assumes that the first jump must be of 1 unit. Now, if the frog's last jump was k units, its next jump must be either k-1, k or k+1 units. The frog can only jump in the forward direction. We are given two sample examples with a problem. In the first example, we were able to reach the last stone. That's why we return true, otherwise we return false. So now let's first see what this question is all about and how we can solve this. We are given this input array and the frog is resting at the index 0. What these values at each of the index in the array represent? These values in the array will make much more sense when we plot all the values ranging between 0 to n on a straight line. Once we do that, the values that are present in the array were nothing but the position of the stones and rest of the values were nothing but the position of the water. Now, as given in the question, a frog can jump forward on any of the stone. He may jump any number of steps, but he cannot jump on the water. So we need to take care of the fact that any jump that the frog is making from a stone should not land him in the water. And by continuously jumping the frog from one stone to other, we need to find out if we are able to reach the last stone or not. Now, coming back to the one of the stones. Now, there are certain conditions attached to the number of jump a frog can make from a particular index. The condition states that if the previous jump was of k units, then the next jump must be either k-1, k or k+1 units. Now, what this particular statement means? It means that when we jump from 0 to 1, we jumped 1 unit. So that becomes our previous jump. Now, in order to find out how many jumps that we can make from index 1, we have only three options. The next jump can either be 0 units, 1 unit or 2 units. Now, jumping 0 units doesn't make any sense. So, we'll see what jumping 1 unit and 2 unit means. We can either reach the index 2 or index 3 by jumping 1 or 2 units respectively. And as we know, if we jump only one step, then we will land on water, so we won't take that. We'll jump 2 units in this case and land on another stone. When we reach the index 3, the previous jump that we took now becomes 2. So the next jump that we can take from index 3 can be either 1, 2 or 3. So the 3 jumps will land us to index 4, 5 or 6. Taking one step only will land us at index 4, which is a water position. We cannot go over there. And the other two will land us on two different stones. Here we are taking two steps, landing at a stone 5, and we will continue to jump from one stone to the other and see if we are able to reach the last stone by doing so. So when we reach the index 5, we took two jumps. So the next jump are 1, 2 or 3. We take 3 jumps, land on index 8. The previous jump becomes 3. The next jumps are 2, 3, 4. We take 4 jumps, land on index 12, previous jump becomes 4, next jump 3, 4, 5, and lastly we take 5 jumps and reach the last stone, that is 17 in this case. And we return true that we can reach the last stone by following the conditions given to us in the problem. In this approach that we are following, we will often run into cases wherein our jump will lead us to land on water, which is unnecessary. There will be a lot of combinations that can occur when we jump from one stone to other because the previous jump might change for the same index. But I want to clarify that this is also a valid solution. It will take higher time complexity to solve with this approach and we can optimize it a little bit by storing some of the intermittent data. So how we can really optimize it? So we know that in this approach, we will often have the condition to land on water, and we do not want to run into those conditions because that is unnecessary for us. We'll make changes in our approach. If we just have the input array that is given to us, what we really need is if we are able to reach the succeeding indexes from the current index, and if it is possible, we'll continue to do so till we reach the last index. If we can reach the last index at any point of time with any combination, we'll return true. Otherwise, the answer will remain false. Over here, we do need to follow the condition that the previous jump, if it was k, then the next jump should be k minus 1, k or k plus 1. But we do not know what was the previous jump. So, value of the previous jump is nothing but the value that we get when we reach from the last index to the current index. The difference of the two values is nothing but our previous jump. So, the index 1 becomes our last index and index 3 becomes our current index. And the previous jump or the last jump is nothing but the difference of the value at the current index and the last index. So now we have the last index. Now we need to find out what was the next jump that we took. The next jump is purely dependent upon the next index that we are going to. The next index can lie anywhere between current index plus 1 till the last index of the array. So the new jump or the next jump is nothing but the difference between the value of the next index and the value of the current index. So now we have both the jumps, the last jump and the new jump, and we have the preconditions or the relationship between the two jumps. We just need to find out if our new jump and the last jump follow the conditions or not. If they follow the condition, then it is possible to jump from the current index to the next index. Otherwise, it is not. This saves us the computation wherein we are checking for all the jumps from the current index and sometimes landing on water. So the condition that we need to check over here is if the new jump is equal to the last jump minus 1 or the last jump or the last jump plus 1. If it is true, then we jump on that particular next index. The next index becomes our current index. Current index becomes our last index and we again follow the same approach. At this particular current index and last index, let's see what will be the value of last jump and new jump. So the last jump in this case becomes 3 minus 1 equals to 2. The new jump becomes 6 minus 3 equals to 3. If the next index is supposed to be index 4. Which has the value as 6. So now we have the new jump and the last jump, and we see that they follow the condition. New jump is 3, last jump was 2. So new jump is equal to last jump plus 1. So we can jump from index 2 to index 4. That is a valid jump. Now that it is possible to move to the next index with the value 6, we recursively call our method with now the current index as the value 4, 2 being the last index, and all the rest of the value being the next index. We'll continue to do so, and whenever we reach the last stone, we'll return true. Otherwise, we will return false at the end. So in this problem also, we can optimize it by storing some of the intermittent values. There may be a lot of time that we will be encountering the same last index, current index combination, and we can store if we have already calculated that particular last index and current index combination so that we do not recompute the same value again and again. This will help us to lower the time complexity and get faster results. Now, talking about the technique that we use in order to solve this problem, we are using recursion and memoization. What we are effectively doing is we are starting with the last index as 0 and the current index as 1, and we are trying to find out the next index to jump on. And if it is possible to make the jump. If it is possible to make the jump, we are recursively calling the methods with the updated indexes, what we saw earlier. The last step that we have mentioned over here is an optimization effort in which we are maintaining if we have already processed any last index and current index combination in the past. If we have already processed it, we can directly return the result and that will save us a lot of time. As always, I'll recommend you to solve this particular approach on your own, and you can always come back if you face any issue. Now it's time to code this particular approach. So we'll first implement the core logic and then we'll implement the optimization effort. We discussed that we need to have a method which we'll be calling recursively. So it will be a helper method. We'll pass the stones. We need the last index and the current index, what we discussed. We need to just return the helper. Now let's first implement this helper method. We also discussed that if anywhere the current index is equals to the last index of the stones array, we need to return true because we have reached the last stone in the array. So we'll have that condition over here. Now we need to find out what was the last jump that we made. So the last jump, we discussed that it is nothing but the difference of the current index with the value at the last index. So that becomes our last jump that we made. Now, what is the next index that we need to move on to? The next index is nothing but the current index plus 1, and we will be incrementing it. For every index, we will first check, call the recursive function and increment it. So till this next index is less than the array length. And also we need to check if this jump that we are taking is equals to either the last jump minus 1, last jump or last jump plus 1. So it should be less than the last jump plus 1. So this new value, which is at the next index, should be less than or equals to the current value plus the last jump plus 1. Now we can easily move this current index over here as well. It is one and the same thing to write the equation in this format. Once we are inside this, we are sure that this is a valid move that we have made. We just need to check if this falls under the range of last jump minus 1 to last jump plus 1. So the next jump that we made, stones next index minus the current index. So to find what was the actual jump that we made, we can minus the new jump from the last jump. Now all we need to do is we need to check if the jump is greater than or equals to minus 1 and less than equals to 1. This line just checks if the value is in between minus 1 to 1. We could have done it without the jump variable as well, but this is much more clear. So now if we have the jump in between minus 1 and 1, we are sure that it is a valid jump to this last index, and we just now need to check if it is possible to move to the further indexes. In this case, the last index becomes the current index with which we have worked, and the current index is the next index. If we were to get a true value from this helper, somewhere we reach the last stone, then we directly return true because it is of no use to compute any further. Outside this while loop, we need to increment our next index in order to check for the other indexes. And at the end, we can simply return false, because if there is no index from which we can reach the last index over here, it will be a false value by default. So this solution will work fine, but the only thing is the last index and the current index value might repeat themselves. There will be cases wherein we will be computing the same values again and again, and in order to remove that, we need to have a 2D array. Now, why we are taking a 2D array? Because there will be a lot of combination, or we can say every combination of 0 to n with itself. You can also use map, creating a string key with a combination of last index and current index. That is also fine. For simplicity, we are using a 2D array to just mark if we have already computed that value or not. So we can do that by using a boolean. So we define this DP array at class level, so we can use that in this helper method itself. Whenever we are out of this while loop, we can just update this DP with the last index and current index true, denoting that we have already calculated this last index and current index, and it turns out to be true. We have visited it and we cannot reach the last index by using this particular combination. That also makes sense, because if the last index and current index are the same, then the last jump will be the same, the next indexes will be the same, and there is no point in recalculating the same values. So if anyway the current index is stone length minus 1, we are returning true. Here we will add one more condition, that if the DP of last index and current index is true, that means we have already seen and calculated those values and it is false, because we haven't reached last stone in the array using this combination, so it is false directly. Now this particular problem is complete. So let's first dry run this. The main logic is in our helper method, in which we are seeing if the current index is equals to the last index of the array, then we directly return true because we have reached the last stone. We find out the last jump and the next index and check if the next index is within the boundaries, checking if we can reach the next index if it is in well within the boundaries of last jump plus 1. Then we find out what was the next jump that we took and the difference of the two jumps. If the difference of the two jump is anywhere between minus 1 to 1, we recursively call with the updated indexes, and if it gives true, we return true. We increment next index inside this while loop. Outside, we are just marking these last index and current index combination to be true. That means we have visited those particular combination, and at the end, we just return false. Now let's try to run this code for all the sample test cases. So it ran successfully. Let's submit this. Okay, so we got a wrong answer, and for the input 0, 2. Now this is a very special case because we cannot cover that in this helper method. We can write a specific condition for it. As we all know that the first jump should be of length 1. We need to check if the value at index 1 is 1, because if that is not the case, then we cannot reach any of the index. So we'll put that condition over here. We'll see if the value of 1, the value at index 1 is not 1, then we can simply return false. There is no point in calculating that value. Let's resubmit this. So now it got submitted successfully. The time complexity in this case is O of n square, as there can be at most n square combination of last index and current index that we may run into. The space complexity is also n square because we are using a two-dimensional DP array. Let me also show you the code for the initial approach that we discussed, in which we are going through every jump from every index. The code took 549 milliseconds. So this was the code that I have used in order to find out with the approach that we discussed. You can try this one too and find out if there is a way to optimize it as well. I'll put both the codes in the Git repo. You can find the link in the description below. I hope this video helped you. Do let us know your thoughts in the comments below. Thanks for watching this video. See you in the next one.